The band absolutely slaying that song. That was amazing. I'm like feeling ready to go TP somebody's house or something. I'm not sure why, but feeling it. But we are going to talk tonight about a story of some people who were asking some similar questions to that song that we just heard. Some of those questions that we just listened to. But before we get there, if we've not met, my name is Abbie. I am so glad that you're here today. Whether you're here in the venue or you're joining us online, super pumped that you have decided to be a part of what we're doing this weekend. And I have to say, I am feeling especially jealous of those of you who may be tuning in from somewhere on spring break, somewhere tropical maybe, or those of you in this room who are getting ready to head somewhere like that. See, over the course of this last week, my family and I has actually moved into a new house. And if you've ever moved before, then you know a bit of how we're feeling right now. I could use a week of just, you know, sitting on the beach. That sounds pretty nice. So if you're about to do that, or if you're doing that right now, just soak it in, think of me, send me the vibes. I would love that. But you know, this was moving day for us. Last weekend, this is my son Roman. He was taking advantage that morning of the emptied out cabinet to have a little breakfast cave. And for us, this move has been a long time coming. We moved into our last house, fresh out of college, just married, and it was an awesome place, a little South Broderpo bungalow. But 8 years later, 2 kids later, the limits of that house were starting to feel a little confining. And so we'd been looking forward to this move really for a couple of years, starting to plan for it, watching the market, getting our house ready, all of those things. And last summer, when my daughter was born, we had decided, you know, the market was insane, I'm sure you know. And so we decided to set up a nursery in the corner of our bedroom because we didn't have any spare rooms. And that was fine for a little while until she got old enough to become aware of her surroundings and then got wise enough to realize the power that she had over us in the middle of the night. Because when she woke up, and we certainly did not want to wake up. And so she got pretty good at getting what she wanted. So all of that to say that we were ready for this move is a major understatement. So about a month ago, we finally, after looking at several places, putting a couple offers down, we finally found a place that we loved, that we thought would be a good fit. And so we eagerly wrote up an offer. And the next day, our realtor called us and said, "Congratulations, it's yours. The offer was accepted." And in that moment, as I'm taking that call, I look at my husband, and it's like the blood drains from his face. He looks as if we have just received the worst news possible. Now, this wasn't entirely surprising. My husband has always been a little allergic to commitment. We had to have an actual conversation before our wedding where I sat him down and I was like, "Okay, I just need to make sure that you are not going to panic when we get to this moment. Like, I'm pretty sure you want to get married, but when we get to the moment where it's time for you to say I do, will you promise me that you won't say I might?" or something like that. And he didn't. It was good. I forgot my vows. He was all good. But anyway, so it wasn't super surprising that he was reacting that way. But what did surprise me was that I was feeling the similar kind of way. That all of a sudden, instead of the excitement that I was expecting, there was this fear that started to rise up. These questions that started to flood my mind. Questions like, did we make the right choice? Throughout the following week or two, we rode this roller coaster of second guessing. And feeling really thankful now that we're in our house, I'm not there anymore. I've kind of worked through that, but it took some time to come around to that. And I was reminded in the process that it is normal. Anytime we are making a big decision, making a big commitment, to find ourselves second guessing. You've probably experienced this in one way or another. Maybe for you, you've experienced some second guessing when you've made a bold move in your business or a career change. Maybe in the aftermath of a breakup, or when you've made a new commitment to get involved with something, coaching, volunteering somewhere, taking on a side gig. Last weekend, many of us around here took a leap together. We decided to sacrifice some things in our lives so that we together can fuel the mission of what's happening here, the renewal that we believe God wants to bring in our community over the next several years. And maybe if you were one of the people that was a part of that last weekend, maybe you have been feeling a bit of a commitment hangover this week as you think about what you placed in the joy box last weekend. I got you there. Maybe you found yourself wondering, did we make the right choice? Did I make the right choice? Maybe you've not yet had a chance to make a one-time gift and a three-year financial commitment as a part of this Renew initiative. And as Kurt mentioned a minute ago, there's still time for that. We'll talk more about that in a little bit. But first, I want us to spend some time unpacking this second guessing that we all experience from time to time, to consider how do we move forward when all of those what about questions are at the top of our minds. See, the truth is, these moments of second guessing, these are moments that require wisdom, that require some discernment on our part. Because sometimes those questions and doubts are important things for us to pay attention to, that they are flags that can help us to correct course before we get too far off. But other times, and maybe even more often, the second guessing that we do may actually hinder us more than it helps us. There was a study that was done a few years ago by some British economists who were evaluating sports betting behaviors, and they were trying to figure out who made better decisions, people that trusted their initial gut or the bettors who would second guess and later change their initial bet. And what they found over the course of this study is that those who revised their bets were actually 17% less accurate than those who stuck with their gut, just stayed with that initial bet. And further, of those that changed their mind, the ones that changed their mind right away were actually much better than those who spent more time second guessing and after a longer period of time decided to change their minds. Now, the point of all this is not necessarily to help you make better bets for the Final Four this weekend. Although, I don't think any data could have helped us with predictions for this March Madness. But the point is, maybe we should think twice about how much we trust the questions that come to our minds when we start second guessing. This Sunday, this weekend, is what we call Palm Sunday, which means if you have Easter plans to make, you've got about a week. It's also a day, though, when we often remember a story from the life of Jesus that is filled with people who, just like us, were prone to second guessing. It's a story that shows up in all four of the biographies written about Jesus' life, the gospel accounts. And today we're going to draw mostly from John's version of this story. Let's take a look. We find it in John chapter 12, starting with verse 12. He says, "The next day, a great crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and they went out to meet him, shouting, 'Hosanna,' which means 'God save us. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel.' And Jesus found a young donkey and sat on it, rode on it into the city." Now, this is, let's admit, a weird scene from our modern perspective. So let me tell you a little bit about what's happening here. What's happening is that Jesus and his closest followers, his friends, they are coming to the city of Jerusalem to celebrate Passover, which is a holiday that remembers and celebrates the way that God delivered the people of Israel from slavery in Egypt. And it's important for us to understand that Jesus and his closest friends were Jewish. So for them, coming to Jerusalem for Passover was just what you did. They did this every year. It was kind of like our traditions. A lot of us have holiday traditions that revolve around maybe going to your hometown or gathering in your home. But for them, everyone went to the capital city to celebrate. Imagine if for the 4th of July, it was just normal in our country for everybody to flock to DC. It'd be wild, right? This is what it was like in Jerusalem at Passover. The city would swell to four or five times its normal population. It just was popping. It was bustling. And so this is what they're doing. Jesus and his friends, they're entering Jerusalem just like everybody else. But by this point, Jesus has gained enough notoriety among the Jewish people especially that he is not going to just slip into the city unnoticed.
For the record, I think this is a really stupid move.
Don't worry, I'm gonna keep a real low profile.
Oh, Nice try. You were my appetite.
Okay, I think our definitions of low profile might be a little different.
You think?
All right, so if you're a MacGruber fan and you're thinking, I feel like something is missing from that scene, you're right. We are a church that's more PG-13 than most, but even we have our limits. You may be wondering, though, whether you're a MacGruber fan or you're like, what in the world is that? What in the world does this have to do with the story that we're talking about? Let me tell you. See, in this scene, MacGruber, he just can't help himself. He cannot help but be who he is. Whether he wants to or not, he is making an entrance. And for entirely different reasons and with an entirely different posture, like MacGruber, Jesus has no choice but to make an entrance as he heads into Jerusalem on this day. Now, for us to understand the significance of what Jesus is doing here, we need to know what the people who would have been there that day and who would have first heard this story would have understood, what they would have already known was happening on the other side of the city at the same time. See, on the same day, on the other side of the city, there was another entrance that was happening. The Roman governor, Pontius Pilate, was entering Jerusalem in this grand military procession. He did this every year at this time. He would come from his beach house and he would come into the city for the beginning of Passover. And the picture of the two could not be more different. Pilate enters on this strong horse, surrounded by soldiers decked out in imperial gear, carrying their weapons, and his entrance commanded attention. But people were not celebrating his coming. His entrance represented for them the power structure that made life difficult for almost all people, so that a few at the top could benefit. It would have felt to the people in Jerusalem something like this. I don't know if any of you are familiar. This is from A Bug's Life. This is a movie that came out when I was a kid. And for some reason, this scene in particular has just been burned in my memory ever since. I think I'm just slightly scarred from it. But it's a good example of how the people in Jerusalem would have felt as Pilate makes his entrance into the city. He is coming as a reminder of the power and dominance of Rome, to make sure that as crowds were filling the city that week, that they didn't breed any ideas of revolution. It's a power move. It's a warning to those who had come to celebrate the story of God setting them free from slavery to not get too excited about this idea of freedom. That though God may have delivered their ancestors, they now lived under the rule of Rome. And so, because this was happening on one side of the city, Jesus' entrance that day makes a bold statement in contrast. The horse that Pilate rode was a symbol of war. It was meant to conjure fear and compliance. But the donkey was a well-known symbol for peace. It was the marker of a different kind of leader, a kind of king that brought peace. In fact, John actually clues us in to what the crowd would have been thinking as they saw Jesus on this donkey. He tells us, as it is written, remember, do not be afraid, daughter Zion, which just means people of Jerusalem. See, your king is coming, seated on a donkey's colt. Now, this is a paraphrase of words that were written by the Old Testament prophet Zechariah, who centuries earlier had talked about a king that would come to Jerusalem humble and riding on a donkey. Zechariah goes on, and just in the verse after this, going on to describe the kind of king this would be. saying, "He will take away chariots from Ephraim and war horses from Jerusalem. The battle bow will be broken. He will proclaim peace to the nations. His rule will extend from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth." See, on one side of the city, there is an entrance, and the message is clear. Power, domination, weapons, threats, fear. And then there's Jesus, making an entrance on the other side of the city that is proclaiming an entirely different way. A way of love, humility, freedom, hope, peace. This is why the people are so excited that Jesus is coming. This is the reason that they are welcoming him into the city with this parade, why they're throwing palm branches down and all kinds of other things, why they're celebrating his coming, because they know his reputation. They know this about him, and they are saying, this is the kind of leader that we want to follow. They are campaigning for Jesus to become their king. But what they don't know is what's ahead. See, over the course of the next week, every person in that crowd who was confidently calling for Jesus to be their leader would eventually find themselves second-guessing. The next day, Jesus would enter the temple and start flipping over tables, upending, disrupting the way that things had always been done. And some people who had been in the crowd the day before, as they watch him do this, they begin to second-guess their excitement. The day after that, this crowd would have been listening as Jesus gave some speeches and answered a series of questions posed by people who are trying to figure out his platform. They're trying to figure out, what is he all about? What kind of kingdom is he trying to create? And many of them would have been surprised by his answers, by the way that he was critical of people that they respected, by the way that he talked more about enduring suffering than relieving suffering, how when they wanted some clear answers, he gave vague responses. And as they listened, more started to second guess. Then on Wednesday, Jesus is at a party, and there's this uninvited guest who comes in, and there's a strange encounter with Jesus. She kind of makes the scene, and the people who are supposed to be at this party are like, "I don't know about that." And they're pretty sure Jesus is going to be on their side, except that he's not. He sides with this woman, and he actually criticizes them for their judgment of her. And again, more people begin to second guess. By Thursday, many of the people who'd been in that crowd on Sunday have moved beyond second guessing. They've decided this is not our guy after all. This is how, after Jesus is arrested just 4 days after that grand entrance into Jerusalem, we find a very different crowd. It's not different people. Many of them would have been the same ones that were in the crowd laying down palm branches just days before, welcoming him into the city. But the opinion of the crowd has changed dramatically. See, on this night, again, we see Jesus and Pilate could not be more opposite. Jesus is brought before Pilate to be put on trial. And, you know, Pilate's job, the reason that he's in the city, is to maintain order. And so this is his role. If there's someone that they say is causing trouble, it's his job to take care of it. And the stakes are high for him. If he doesn't get this right, he's not only losing his job, he's probably losing his life. But Pilate's in a tricky spot here with Jesus, because he realizes that the people who handed Jesus over had done so out of their own self-interest, that they had trumped up his charges. And so it's clear to Pilate that Jesus is probably not actually guilty, or at least not guilty enough to deserve to die. Plus, right in the middle of the trial, as he's hearing the case, Pilate's wife actually sends word to him and says, I got a bad feeling about this. She had this feeling that he shouldn't get involved, that he wouldn't want this blood on his hands. And so what does he do? Pilate remembers that there is this tradition that every year at Passover, one prisoner is set free. And so he devises this plan. He picks out the most hated criminal in the holding cells, and he pulls him out, and he sets him and Jesus in front of the crowd and says, who do you choose? Who do you want to set free, Jesus or that guy? Thinking that they will, of course, choose Jesus. But that's not how it goes down. The tide has turned. The opinion of the crowd has changed, and they are set against Jesus. And so Pilate gives up. He walks over to a basin of water, and he begins to wash his hands. And he does this as a symbol that he is not going to take responsibility for this decision, even though it is his decision to make. He washes his hands, and then he hands Jesus over to die. But you know, earlier that same night, while Jesus was having a final meal with his friends, he also had picked up a basin for washing. But he doesn't wash his hands. He doesn't give up the responsibility. Instead, what Jesus does is he stoops down. He takes on the position of a servant, of a slave. And he begins to wash the feet of his friends, friends that he knows are about to betray him, friends that he knows are not going to stand by him in just a few hours as Jesus faces the most excruciating moments of his life. And in this scene, Jesus again makes clear that he is an entirely different kind of leader. See, Pilate embodies a way that is still dominant in our culture, protecting power, looking out for you and yours, taking care of number one, avoiding responsibility when the stakes get too high. But Jesus, on the other hand, demonstrates the unexpected power of pouring yourself out for others, of personal sacrifice for a greater good. This story, this week leading to Easter, begs us to ask ourselves, which kind of leader do I want to follow? Which kingdom do I want my life to be about? Will we choose the seduction of a life that looks out first and foremost for ourselves, and in so doing, take on the power struggles and the anxieties that inevitably come with that? Or will we choose to follow the self-emptying way of Jesus, knowing that it will include sacrifice and surrender, and yet trusting that this is also the way to life? To real hope, to real freedom for us and for others. This is the question. This is the renewal that we are seeking together. And it's the central story of our faith, that God is always in the business of making all things new, of bringing to life what we thought was dead. A new thing springs up. Can you see it? Can you perceive it? The story of Jesus' last week reminds us that the road to renewal, the way toward resurrection and new life, may look different than we expect. There will be moments when we can't help but second guess, when we'll wonder if we've made the right choice, when we'll find ourselves asking, what about us? But here's the hope in this story. It's twofold. First of all, for those who stuck with Jesus, the few who remained with him through all of the ups and the downs of this week, who were with him at the foot of the cross as he died, they are the ones who were the first witnesses to his resurrection. They stuck with him and therefore got the gift of experiencing new life first, of playing a critical role in the turning point of history. And the others, the ones who let that second guessing get the better of them, who walked in a different direction, their story was just beginning. Jesus poured out his life so that we might see that his invitation remains open, that we can still decide to follow his way. See, chasing after the renewal that God wants to bring in our lives is not about one big moment, one big decision. It's about choosing day after day, moment after moment. Every day, we have opportunities to decide what kind of leader do I want to follow. Every day, we have new opportunities to say, okay, I'm going to step in this direction. I am going to embody the way of the kingdom that Jesus had modeled for us. It's a path that we have the chance to choose again and again. In fact, we have to choose again and again. And to do this, we need to know that we're not in it alone. We can help each other fight the doubts and the questions that come in those second-guessing moments. We can follow together the example of Jesus as we keep choosing the path that God has for us. I want to give us a few principles as we start to wrap up today that we've seen in this story that I think can help us to move forward. And honestly, I think are helpful regardless of whether you're ready to buy the faith parts of this story or not. The first is this. Don't let fear make decisions for you. Pilate not only led with fear, he lived captive to it. Jesus was not exempt from fear. He experienced it, he felt it, and then he rose above it. He was guided by love instead of fear. In our moments of second guessing, as you consider the decisions that are looming in your life right now, let love guide you. The voice of fear might be loud, but it's not going to lead you anywhere that you want to go. Second principle we can draw from this story is to step up instead of stepping back. We can see in Jesus' example that there is a power in assuming responsibility, in taking on a challenge instead of shrinking back. There's so many ways that this can play out in our lives, in our family lives, in our work lives, and for sure in our spiritual lives. I'm in grad school right now, and one of my professors who, fun fact, when he was in middle school, he had a youth pastor named Kurt Walters. Maybe you've heard of him. This professor, he made a comment this week about how most churches, most Christians, have a tendency to lean in one of two directions. Either we have a high expectation for people to change, and with it, a high level of judgment when people don't do what we think that they should do. Or other churches, other Christians lean in the other direction, where we have a low level of judgment. We're really welcoming, we're really easy to get along with, but we also don't really ask much. There's also low expectations that people will actually change or could do something significant. And the problem with this is that both are missing what Jesus was about. See, Jesus, he was kind of had a foot in both places. Jesus was a person who offered absolutely no judgment, who extended forgiveness again and again and again. And yet, he is also a person who showed us this call to radical change, who regularly was inviting people to give up more than they thought that they could give up, to step into things that they thought was beyond the courage and the strength and the gift that they had. He was constantly not judging, but calling to this high expectation. And this is the heart behind the Renew Initiative. It's not just a practical thing. It's about aligning ourselves to the invitation and the heart of Jesus. It's about this core belief that God has set up the church to work in such a way that we already have everything we need to thrive, as long as we all are doing our part. maybe today, you're ready to step up and to get on board. If you've not yet had the chance to join the many that have made commitments over the past week, today's a great day to do it. And by the way, I do want to give a little disclaimer. If you're a guest with us, if you're just checking things out around here, I hope that it's clear to you that there is absolutely no expectation for you to jump in with this. You're, of course, welcome if you want to, but this is really for our partners and regulars, for those of us who call Crosspoint home. Here's how, if you're like, okay, today's the day, I'm jumping in, I'm ready to make a commitment. Here's what you can do. If you are online or you want to do this online, you can scan the QR code or text RENEW to 317-834-7373. And then for those of us in person, it's a little easier. This card, you can take this envelope. And I want to walk you through a little bit. Here on this top line in pink, it says, my gift today. This is your one-time first fruits gift. And then the next line is where you put your three-year commitment, what you will give over the course of 3 years. And we're not holding you to this, but this is just a, I'm making this commitment to God and to the church as a whole. And then this third line, this is where you total those two lines to give a total gift. Simple math. I have to tell you, as we look at this part, all of this, this whole RENEW initiative is new to me and to my husband. We've never been a part of a church that's had an opportunity like this. And so as we have been walking through these last few weeks, it's been eye-opening. We've been curious. We've also been a little apprehensive. And as we sat down to have this conversation, to talk about the numbers, what happened for me is that I started to feel some fear. Especially about that kind of pink line, that the timing of this first fruits gift, because the weekend of commitment weekend was also the weekend that I knew we were having to come to a closing table and bring money to that place. And so the timing just felt wild. It felt like I just don't know about this. And as I started to raise these questions, my allergic to commitment husband that I told you about earlier, who also is notoriously a cheapskate, he was the one who was unwavering. He's hearing me for a little bit, and then he was like, no, I'm pretty confident. I think this is what we should do. And I tell you this because it was a moment for us. And these kinds of step-up moments, these are opportunities that can change us, that have a way of forging deeper connections with God, but also with one another. And we don't want you to miss that. Another opportunity that does this, that has a way of changing us, another way that you might want to step up to this weekend is by joining a volunteer team. This is equally part of this RENEW initiative. There are still 15 roles right now that we're looking to fill, largely with our kids, with our students. Pretty good place, if you ask me. And with our greeting team, all three of these are awesome teams to jump in, to be a part, to say, I'm going to step up and join the work that God is doing in these places. You can let us know on that volunteer commitment card or online, on the online digital commitment card. Remember, if you're online, if you're filling all this out, don't forget to hit send. You don't want to lose all that progress. If you're in person, you can drop both of these in the joy box as you leave. I can't wait to see what God will do in you, through you, in us, around us, as we step into this opportunity. And know that as you do this, you are joining hundreds of people who have gone before you, who have took this step over the past week. For me, watching this that happened last weekend, watching all of the people come forward and place their envelopes into the box, that was the moment that there was a turning point for me, where that fear went away and I turned toward excitement to get to be a part of this, to get to see what God is going to do. And we can't wait to celebrate together on April 13th and 16th. You're not gonna get to see that moment, but you do, I want you to know that there are people who have paved the way for you. So join us and get ready to celebrate with us in a few weeks. The last principle that we pull from this story before we wrap up today is this. It's simple. Stay the course. Now, when I say this, I'm not saying that we never adjust our plans, that we never shift our strategies, but stay the course in a more foundational way. This is back to the questions that we were talking about a moment ago. Staying the course is about deciding which leader you want to follow and then staying committed to that mission day after day, choosing to live by the example of Jesus. Maybe today you're in a place where something's clicking in a different way and you're ready to make that decision for the first time. Or maybe you're in a place where you just need a moment to recalibrate, that this is already the way that you've decided to go, but it's time to take another step, a step toward love, a step toward humility, a step toward pouring yourself out for a greater purpose. I hope that as you think about these three principles, that you'll find them to be useful. I think that they really have power to move us forward as we open ourselves up to what God might want to do in and through us during this Holy Week and in the weeks and months to come. Guided by love, not fear. Stepping up instead of stepping back. Choosing to stay the course each day, just as Jesus did for us. Now, if you're sitting here thinking, yeah, I don't know if I'm ready for any of that, I want to offer just one more option that I would ask you to consider. Will you come back and join us for Easter next weekend at Crosspoint? Just show up, tune in, see what happens. Give it a shot. We'll have a spot for you. And we'll also have easy exits if you change your mind. The band's going to lead us in one more song that's going to help us to get ready to walk this out, to move forward in whatever direction is in front of us and the path that's set ahead. And as we get ready to do this, I want you to invite you to stand with us. Let me pray for us as we move into this moment. God, thank you for being the kind of leader worth following, for offering us an alternative to the way that we see all around us. God, I pray that you would give each one of us the wisdom that we need to see the path that you have set before us. And then that you would give us the courage, that you would give us the stamina to take that step forward, to stay the course, to keep going, to spur one another on toward what you have for us so that we might experience the fullness of the life that you want to offer us. You're so good to us. Thank you for who you are.